Well, first I'd like to add my thanks, if I may, to the organiser of this quite amazing Best in Heritage Conference for bringing us all together again, this international family of passionate museum and heritage professionals, so that we can learn from each other and return reinvigorated to our jobs, reinvigorating our shared belief in the unifying power of culture. A health warning about what I'm going to say for the technophiles amongst you. The project that I was involved with does not contain any interactive touchscreens or computer technology. It's a very simple conservation project, and it's about traditional building materials, stone, brick, timber, and the almost magical properties of lime mortar and lime washes. But I hope too that it was about ideas and meaning. And it was also about ruin. We've already heard a good deal about ruins in the last couple of days. Only this morning, a sobering and inspiring story of Vukovar. We've heard too about iconoclasm in ancient Sardinia. And we've heard about the threat that earthquakes pose to archive repositories in Latin America. Ruins were once the preserve of antiquaries and poets, but I've noted with interest in the last few years that there's a new generation of ruin seekers armed with digital cameras and social media savvy who are demonstrating very clearly the continuing poignancy and relevance of ruins, reminding us of the ongoing parable of ruins and what you might describe as the Ozymandias syndrome. Ruined buildings are powerful, and they speak in ways that complete buildings cannot, stirring our emotions differently. There are usually three routes to ruin, and each may provoke in us a different response. Violence, whether at the hand of man or nature, accident, and abandonment, and I've put up three examples here. But with the passage of time, years, centuries, millennia even, ruins soften, and despite our best efforts, memory fades or is refashioned by history. Time-worn ruins tend to fill us with wonder and trigger in us contemplative, poetic thoughts. They're a type, I think, of memento mori, blind to social status, and they inspire us to think not only about the impermanence of man's works, but also they enable us to create anew from the fire rises the phoenix. And of course, ruins are universal, or at least in all cultures that have built. But I think in the English psyche particularly, though not uniquely, ruins particularly haunt us. And they're a constant refrain in literature and painting. They're elegiac and they're picturesque. Why is that? Well, Henry VIII's great schism with Rome and his dissolution of the monasteries in the 16th century is probably to blame. Reformed church buildings were sold off, they were converted into houses, they were pulled apart for their building materials, or they were simply left to rot. And the chaos of the Civil War in the 17th century added shattered medieval castles and abbeys to the country's ruinous landscape. And in the 18th and 19th centuries, some landowners were able to exploit ruined buildings on their estates, incorporating them within newly created landscape gardens. And here are examples at Sudley Castle and Scotney Castle. In the Scotney example, the building in the foreground is a 14th century a fragment of a castle enjoyed by the 19th century house above it. Well, their motivation for appropriating ruins varied, and the messages that they wanted to convey were often diametrically opposed. For some, a precious Gothic fragment might signal their family's long and noble lineage, their piety for the past perhaps, or their defiant adherence to the old faith which had been swept away in the mid-16th century. For others, that very same past was seen as barbaric. Broken Gothic architecture symbolised instead the triumph of classicism, and in the mid-18th century, early 18th century rather, and onwards, Palladian-inspired architecture, favoured by the grandees of the Whig Party, which dominated British politics for most of the 18th century, became the official language of government and was seen, at least by some, as a civilising influence. But there was a third variant, a convergence, if you like, of those apparently opposite ideas, as here in the landscape gardens at Stowe. It was a period preoccupied by the respective rights of Parliament and monarch. This is after the country has executed its king. And in this context, medieval heritage could also symbolise the defence of ancient English liberties. And the barons who forced the king to sign Magna Carta were much admired in the 18th century, particularly amongst parliamentarians. So it's about the balance of power. Well, for those who didn't have ruins on their land, there was another option. They could build their own artificial sham or mock ruins, which we sometimes call follies, and a good many structures of this type, derived from the architecture of the castle and the abbey, were built in the 18th century English landscape garden. And this is exactly what the Earls of Hardwick, who were successful lawyers and relative newcomers to the upper echelons of society, did on their estate at Wimpole in Cambridgeshire. So the conservation of these artificial ruins that they built, which I shall refer to as the Gothic Tower, was awarded a Europa Nostra Grand Prix in 2006. And it's my very great honour to tell you about the project on behalf of all those who were involved with it. Firstly, I should say that Wimpole is one of the properties in the care of the National Trust, a quite remarkable not-for-profit organisation, independent of government, which owns and manages for public benefit sites of cultural and natural significance across England, Wales and Northern Ireland. It was founded in 1895 and now has an astonishing 5 million members, so it's the largest conservation charity in the United Kingdom. Briefly, a little bit about the history and siting of the Gothic Tower, which you can see marked folly at the top of the central image. It's the focus of Wimpole's apparently naturalistic landscape, which is in fact a designed landscape made by Lancelot Capability Brown, whose life and legacy was celebrated in the United Kingdom last year. More than any other figure, he is associated with the English landscape garden style, le jardin anglais, or de Englische Garten, that's been so influential around the world. And this simple orientation map shows the location of the tower to the north of the historic mansion, which you can see at the bottom, and its relationship with other key components of the landscape, which include a model farm on the right-hand side and a walled garden next to it. So, conceived in about 1750 by the first Earl of Hardwick and his advisor, an amateur architect, a so-called gentleman architect, Sanderson Miller, who was very interested in Gothic architecture, but manifested in what we sometimes know as sort of carpenter's Gothic. It's a naive sort of frilly, almost decorative style, which owes not very much to medieval architecture. But you can see here with the battlements and the nature of the tower, he is actually making references to the medieval towers at places like Warwick Castle. But in fact, strangely, it wasn't built for another 25 years, and then by another generation, the next Earl of Hardwick, with his architectural advisor, James Essex, who was a Cambridge architect, carpenter, and one of the first generation of people in the UK who took a scholarly interest in Gothic architecture. So he started researching along with people like John Britton, trying to really understand how Gothic architecture was in the Middle Ages, and he changed the design slightly, and it was built under the aegis of Capability Brown, who I've mentioned. So the intended conceit here was that an apparently ruinous castle with three towers joined by fragments of curtain wall pierced by gateways would inspire in all those who viewed it and visited it associative thoughts, history, civil war, romance, very much along the lines that I've already outlined. And great interest was taken in it at the time when it was built. And here at the top is an engraving published by the family privately, and beneath it a verse which I'm afraid you're not going to be able to read, but this celebratory verse refers specifically to Magna Carta, and it implies that the pseudo-Gothic form of this building was meant to allude to the virtues of ancient imagined ideas of Anglo-Saxon liberty and, by implication, freedom from potential tyranny of the monarch. So all the things that I've already mentioned. Also, the daughter of the family made drawings in the park, and two of the sketches that she made of the Gothic Tower were actually included as images on the dessert service made for Catherine the Great of Russia by the porcelain manufacturer Czar Wedgwood. And if we can just show a very brief video now about an allied project which explores how topographical views were made in the 18th century with the aid of a clawed glass, a small pocket mirror, in which artists could view images and draw from that reflection. And you can see in one of the nine structures that we're here with, the setup of the reflection
installation, which celebrates the 300th birthday of Capability Brown. Our proposal is nine overscaled easels which sit within the landscape and encourage the visitors to Wimpole to imagine looking at the landscape through the eyes of an artist. It's always an amazing experience to see things translated from an initial sketch to physical reality, and it's an absolute buzz to see it become real.
Shortest video ever. So, the two-year-long project, which we called Precision Ruination, Rescuing Wimpole's Gothic Tower, was by its nature an unusual one. The idea of deliberately designing a structure as if it were ruinous, a relict of an earlier building, is of course a fictive conceit, and in some ways it reminds me of an amazing Roman mosaic I saw years ago in Tunisia, of a lion skin stretched out on the floor as if it was a real rug, sort of layers of conceit and complexity. And here you can see the state of the tower and its curtain walls before we started work. But another layer of complexity revealed itself before the conservation project could begin. A key intellectual and practical challenge was actually making the case for the repair of the building. And I imagine that this might be a challenge to others who are tackling the repair of artfully ruined buildings. So the response was, well, how can a ruin suddenly be ruinous? After all, isn't that the state that it was supposed to be in? And the inevitable refrain, do we really have to spend money on this? So it was about recognising when a designed ruin was actually ruinous. Advocacy, of course, becomes more straightforward when aesthetic ruination first becomes disfiguring and then dangerous, and when signs reading danger of falling masonry and fences need to be put up. Well, ruinous structures are, of course, particularly difficult to maintain in stasis, whether they are real or artificial, because they normally have very few roofs and great lengths of unprotected wallheads. And they need as much, if not more, regular maintenance than intact buildings do. And since the end of the 19th century, and here we have two 19th century images, when a gamekeeper last lived in the tower, Wimpole's Gothic Tower appears to have been abandoned to its picturesque fate, a de facto ruin, and ivy and other fittingly romantic vegetation was allowed to climb unchecked on its walls. This gap between the idea of sustaining a frozen image of ruination and practical realities, I realise, actually surfaces in the 18th century. So as soon as it's built, the same daughter of the family who made those drawings complains in a letter that Capability Brown had unpicturesqued it. She writes, making it a continuous solid object instead of a broken one. And she's disappointed that it's not more fractured, but of course, as an architect, he knows that it's got to stand up. Well, the materials used in the construction of the Wimpole ruins, a mixture of brick and soft, locally dug limestone known as clunch, exacerbated the problems associated with its exposed hilltop site. The chosen material was particularly unsuitable for the distinctive mock battlements, which you should be able to see on the top there. Exposed to the worst of wind, rain, and frost damage, in the 1920s, they had to be removed, and this rather severe brick capping put in its place. And in the 1970s, a new lead roof was added behind that parapet wall to protect the tower's interior. So for many years, the folly looked more like an industrial water tower than a polite parkland building. But of course, that intervention was incredibly important because it kept the building going. So the idea of conserving the folly, the tower, in a more fundamental way to recover the meaning and aesthetic impact of its design intention has been gestating for a very long time. The aims and objectives of the project then were to stabilise the ruins using appropriate materials, respecting their time-worn beauty, and to restore their immediate landscape setting, which had become very overgrown and degraded. And the project also enabled the reinstatement of missing elements such as the crenellations, whilst preserving the picturesque aesthetic of the design intention. And through every step, research, survey, and execution, complex decision-making and great sensitivity were needed. Financial support in the form of higher-level stewardship came from Natural England, which administers environmental stewardship schemes on behalf of the Department of the Environment, Food and Rural Affairs, which has enabled both conservation work and parkland restoration on the estate. And this is quite an unusual source for the conservation of a historic building, but it was given because the tower is so fundamentally a part of the design landscape that enfolds it. In terms of philosophy, our conservation project necessitated a holistic, interdisciplinary approach and the balancing of the site's multiple significances. Archaeology, architectural history, ecology, petrology, scientific fabric analysis, landscape assessment, and social history were all harnessed in the business of understanding the folly and devising conservation solutions. And I think this is really the crux of perhaps why the project won an award. Fragile surfaces were consolidated, lichens were retained where possible, and new elements such as the crenellations that I mentioned and the timber stair to the rear of the building were reinstated. And the building, of course, was made wind and watertight. 13 new Gothic iron-framed windows were forged by a blacksmith following the pattern of surviving examples. Pigeons could no longer gain entry. And these before and after photographs show how damaging plants were removed and wall tops consolidated with lime mortars, how coloured lime washes were used to stabilise the wall surfaces, and how also an army of volunteers sieved mountains of soil to find displaced fragments from the building, window glass, nails, ironwork, catches. 6 tons of guano were removed from the building, and the internal floors were repaired and strengthened. And unusually, perhaps birds of prey were used to clear the site of pigeons and rabbits. And there's now access to the interior via occasional, carefully managed guided tours, and we hope that this is the beginning of another phase, which is to conserve the interior and make that open to the public. The complicated scaffolding to the tower, the curtain walls and the ancillary structures not only gave access to the craftsmen, but they accommodated the public via special tours. 1,000 people visited during the course of the works. And this brings me to the social and community aspects of the project. The landscape at Wimpole, with about 10,000 hectares of agricultural estate, is a very popular green lung for people who live in Cambridge and the surrounding settlements. And the folly, the tower, is a prominent and much-loved landmark at the centre of the estate. So it was particularly important that the wider community was engaged in the conservation project. Not only did they help with that archaeological exercise, but they were involved in bringing the project imaginatively to public's attention. So finally, the Gothic folly, once a neglected-looking structure in the middle of the design landscape, has once more become a meaningful focal point, as it was in the 18th century. Visitors are intrigued by it, and they're led there, not directly, excuse me, but via reinstated circuit path enabled by the removal of agricultural fences, and new planting encourages this. The Trust is very grateful to Natural England for its grant aid, and to the project architect, Donald Insull, who we've heard about already today, the structural engineer, Peter Dan, and particularly to the principal contractor, Trevor Proudfoot, the director of the Clifton Conservation Workshop. And without the vision and leadership of my former colleagues, the senior building surveyor in East Anglia, Paul Coleman, and the curator, Dr. Wendy Monkhouse, the project wouldn't have been impossible. All these people were instrumental in ensuring the precision of this essay in conserving a designed ruin, which we're very honoured has won the approval of Europa Nostra. Thank you.